After hearing that music, I was really tempted to like run back there, come through the doors, and like give everybody high fives, you know? Like, woo! Probably so. So it was probably a good idea I didn't do that. Wow. Time really, really flies. Because it really seems like, I know people say it all the time, feels like yesterday I just started, but it honestly really does. Like, I remember last year in like April, when I came to visit this church for the first time, I knew when I walked in the doors, I was like, this is like where I'm supposed to be next year. Like, I knew that's where I was supposed to be. And you were all like, on that Sunday where I first came in, you were all like super welcoming. Like, a lot of you didn't even know me. Bless you. A lot of you like weren't even sure like why I was here. Some of you came up to me and they said, "Oh, are you Ben's friend?" And I was like, "Well, like, I know Ben, but I wouldn't call us like friends, like super close friends." And then like some of you were like, "Oh, maybe he's the new intern." But like before like knowing who I was, before like knowing anything about me, you were all like super welcoming. And I thought that was just really cool how welcoming you all were. And I've had a great, great year-ish. I've had a great year time with you guys. And I thank you so much for that opportunity to come and to preach on Sundays, to work with the youth. Like, those have been experiences that I'll take with me forever. And I have so many stories now. Like, I have stories with the youth from watching them play with a leaf blower to make it like play with the fire. Cause we were at Karen, that's what I thought. I was pretty sure. We were at Karen's house and we raked a ton of leaves in this huge pile. And then she's like, "Okay, we have to burn them now." And when Devin heard fire, he's like, "What? Where?" And he was, so we started burning the leaves and they were kind of wet, so they didn't like go up that fast. But then one of the youth had this great idea. They're like, "You know, what if we fan the flame with the leaf blower?" I was like, "That should be smart, right? Shouldn't end poorly." So they did it, and then they started going like this, and then the fire just engulfs the leaves. And I mean, that was just so much fun to like get to know them, to hang out with them. I mean, we played with fire. We didn't get hurt. Just so you all know, that story did not end badly, like it probably could have. But like playing with, like working with them, doing the lock-in, that was also a ton of fun, from running around getting shot at with darts to worshiping with them and just giving them that space to open up to Devin and I and just giving that space for them to just truly like pour out like what they're feeling. It's just been a great experience to like grow with them and to just see them grow. You guys have a great, great group of youth here. And it's just been a really good experience for me to like be with them and help them grow and also see like where they're at and like see their passion for this church and also for God. It's just been really, really cool to see. But like my experience is also, like, I loved getting to hang out with like the men of the church at Guys Night. Like, that was so much fun. The last one wasn't as fun because I had to watch the Bears make a really questionable draft pick, but like that was so much fun getting to know them and just hanging out with them. And I just can't thank you guys enough for just allowing me to be here and for being extremely welcoming. And just, I hope that you guys continue to be welcoming for all new people that come to the church. And for like everyone who comes through the doors, I pray and I hope that you guys can treat them like family, because I truly believe that's how you've treated me. And I just thank you so much for that. And you guys will always have a place in my heart, because I will truly miss being able to like worship with you guys. And truly like being a part of worship. I'll miss that. And I just thank you so much for the opportunity. And so many of you have touched my life like more than you know, probably. And one last story, because I don't want to go too long over time. I remember one week, it was a kind of a rough week for me. I wasn't feeling great coming into church. And I walked through the doors and I was standing there talking to some of the youth. And all of a sudden I hear this voice. I hear, "Jacob Johnson?" And I look around, and then I see Sammy Fields runs up to me from the doors and just gives me this huge hug. And she's like, "I missed you. I haven't seen you in a week." And that just made me feel so much better. And it truly just made my week like all the more worth it. Like, I was worried about school and some other stuff, but that just like totally turned my entire like perspective around. Because just like seeing that love from someone. And I don't remember if I ever like said anything specific to Sammy, but she's like giving me a hug every single day since. And it's something I look forward to on Sundays. I was like, just when's she gonna come up? And it's just been like just that small experience is one way. It just shows like how much this entire church just embraces people. And I hope that you guys continue to do that. For the new intern and also everyone who comes through this door, those doors, I pray that you continue to like show them that love and just include them as part of your family, as I felt included. Thank you. Thank you. There we go. So as I was planning this sermon, or Devin said, he's like, "Okay, it's your last sermon. Go out with a bang. You know what? Do." He's like, "Say whatever you want. And then just like, don't leave anything like hanging there." And I was like, "Okay, I tried to do that." But I was like, as I was thinking of something that I wanted to leave you all with, of something that I wanted you guys to remember. It's really, really amazing how the Lord works, because the thing I decided to talk about today is actually the same thing that I wrote about when Pastor Devin and I first met. In our first meeting, Pastor Devin said, "Hey, can you write me a sermon? Because I want to see like where you're at," and he like wanted to know like where I was at in sermon planning and like delivering a sermon. He's like, "Can you write a sermon and we'll go over it next time we meet?" And I was like, "Okay." I was like, "What should it be over?" And he said, "Anything." And I'm like, "Okay." He's like, "Have you seen this book? It's kind of big. Like, I don't know like exactly like be over anything." But I remember I just started reading the Bible, and I came across a story of like a man who was blind and Jesus' interaction with him. And so that's the message I decided to write about. And that's the same message that I am here to talk to you guys about today before getting into it like too much. All right. So have you ever imagined what it would be like to be blind? All right. Everyone, close your eyes for a second. Imagine that you cannot see. Imagine that your entire life, you're just going through life without being able to see what's around you, without being able to see your family, without being able to see those people in the church. It'd be a lot harder to believe what's going on if you can't actually see it. All right, now open your eyes. It's really hard to believe something without being able to see it. There's a lot of skeptics in the world of Christianity, of just things in general, because they're like, "You know what? I can't see it, so there's no way it actually exists. Like, I couldn't see it. There's no way that actually happened. And, for example, I have this friend who he came to church a couple months ago. He's really tall. He's like 6'11". And like, we played basketball together. Well, we were both on the team, and I watched him play basketball. So he's 6'11". He's really, really tall. His name's Tanner. And I always used to give him a hard time because we're friends, and that's what we do. We give each other hard times. So I used to always give him a hard time about not being able to dunk. And for those of you who don't know, like, a lot about basketball, dunking is like when you take the basketball and you put it like directly through the hoop. You like pull on the rim. So I would always give him a hard time about not being able to dunk. I'm like, dude, come on, man. You're 6'11". You're like right by the rim. You just gotta dunk, man. Just jump like that much. The poor kid was not gifted with a bunch of athletic ability, so he could not, or I never saw him dunk. So I'd always be like, dude, come on, man, you're 6'11", you gotta be able to dunk. And then, like, he played travel basketball, so, like, other than with the team, and he'd go around to different places and play basketball, and on several different occasions, he'd come back to school the next day after being at one of his tournaments, and he'd be like, dude, in warm-ups, I dunked it. You wouldn't believe it. Like, I dunked it. I'm like, yeah, sure you did. I was like, you know what? I'll believe it when I see it. Because then like, I actually see you doing it. Like, you could say whatever you want. It doesn't mean that you actually did. And he's like, dude, I really did. I was like, okay, try it. So he'd try to practice, and he'd miss. So it was really hard to believe that he dunked based on just what he was saying. Or another example is, how many of you remember that commercial? It used to play a lot. I don't remember what it was a commercial of, but it used to play a lot. And it was of this fisherman, and he was like sitting on a dock surrounded by these two guys telling this great story of how he, like, last night he was fishing and he caught this huge fish, and he describes the battle with the fish. And he describes, like, the massive, it took him an hour to reel it in. When he finally got up on the boat, it almost sank the boat because it was so big. It was this huge battle, this huge fish. But right at the end of his story, right at the end, as he says, we've got it up onto the boat, and it was like this big. His friend who was with him in the boat comes up behind him and says, hey, what do you mean to do with your fish? And it was like this big. It's hard for us to believe something that we aren't able to see, because naturally we as humans, we want proof. We want to be able to see something to be able to believe it. I bet you of all, or most of you, have, like, someone's told you a story like that and you've been like, you know what, I believe it if I see it, or I'll believe it when I see it. And it's sad because sometimes people make that same argument against Christianity. Sometimes people say, you know what, if I could see God, I'd believe in him. Or they say, if I could see proof of God, I'd believe in him. And it's just hard, it's sometimes really hard to talk to those people. It's sometimes really hard to tell them, like, just because you don't see him doesn't mean he's not there. Like, he is alive in this world. But sometimes those people, they just don't believe. They're like, you know what, I don't believe because I don't see it. And it sometimes it's really hard to talk to those people. And sometimes you yourself might have doubts. You yourself might have doubts about, you know, is God really there? Like, I've never seen him. My life's not that great right now. Is he really there? But what's great is we have this tool. We have the Bible. And the Bible has so many stories about people who doubt. And so many stories about people not being able to see but still believing. So I actually want to focus on a passage from John. It's John chapter 9, verses 35 through 41. The title is Spiritual Blindness. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found them, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Who is he, sir?" the man asked. "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." Then the man said, "Lord, I believe you." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into this world so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind." Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, "What? Are we blind now?" And Jesus asked, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains." So a little backstory to this story is Jesus had earlier healed this man. This man had previously been blind, and Jesus healed him. He allowed him to see. And this man went around telling everybody. Like, he told everybody, he's like, "Jesus, the Son of God, he healed me. Like, I can see now." And he was so excited about that, he just told everybody that he could see now. And then he was in the temple worshiping and telling people, and people got mad that he was saying that this has happened to him. Like, they got really angry at him, so they threw him out. And then that's when the story begins. As Jesus had heard that this man was thrown out, and he went and found him. What I think is really, really powerful about these verses is verse 36. Well, verse 35 and 36, when Jesus says, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And the man said, "Who is he? Tell me so that I may believe in him." I think that shows incredible, incredible faith. The man said, "Tell me so that I may believe in him." He didn't say, "Show me. If I see him, you know, I can believe in him." Because everyone can believe like what they see. No, instead he says, "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Because that man had incredible faith. And he knew in his heart that what Jesus would say would be the truth. And he would know in his heart who Jesus is. And I just think it's amazing that that's exactly what that man says. He doesn't say, "Show me." He doesn't say, "Take me to him." But he says, "Tell me so that I may believe." That's all that man needed to believe, was for Jesus to tell him who the Son of Man was. And then when Jesus did reveal who the Son of Man was, when he says, "He is the one standing before you," that man knew it in his heart who Jesus was. It wasn't because he saw Jesus that he believed he was the Son of Man. It was because he knew it in his heart who he was. And a lot of us, we go through the world seeing things with our eyes. But what if we start seeing things through God's eyes instead? Seeing things and believing things in our heart is way more powerful than just seeing things as they are. Or even, for that matter, seeing people as they are. One verse in this that some people get a little confused on is when Jesus says, "For judgment I have come into this world so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind." And no, I'm almost positive that Jesus didn't mean that if you're blind, you're going to be able to, like, physically blind, not being able to see, you'll be able to see, and then everyone else who could see would be blind. I don't think that's exactly where he was going with this. But I think what he means is those who are blind, those people who are just waiting to believe in Jesus, those people who have it in their hearts to believe in Jesus, or just all people in general, that's why Jesus came into the world. Jesus came into the world for them, to give them hope and to give them life through him. But those who will see, or those who see will become blind. Those are the people that, those are like the Pharisees and the people who don't necessarily believe in Jesus and are just trying to get in other people's way. I think that's what he is saying in like that verse. So the first step, so this sermon is all about three elements. It's believe, see, do. If you don't listen to any other part of the sermon, I hope you still do, but if you don't listen to any other part of this sermon, I want you to go home remembering those three words. Believe, see, and then do. I spent the first part of my sermon talking about the believing and the seeing part. If you truly believed in your heart, then you'll be able to see. Then you'll be able to see God in the world. You'll be able to see those people who have Jesus in them, who like are filled with the Holy Spirit. But first you have to believe. But then, once you believe, and then once you are able to see, then we are all called to do. Because it's one thing to know who God is. It's one thing to be able to see like where there's a need in the community or where there's a need in those people around you. But it's more than that. It's more than just seeing. It's more than just believing. Then we are called to do. Then we're called to see where there's a need in the community. Then we're called to help our fellow man. Like when you're at the office or when you're at school, wherever you are throughout the week, whether you're at home with the family, wherever you are, I guarantee there's people around you that sometimes get on your nerves. I mean, unless you are just happy all the time and no one ever bothers you, then great for you. But I guarantee there's people around you that like get on your nerves. But I also guarantee those same people sometimes are feeling down. Those same people are sometimes not feeling the greatest. We are called to help them as well. We are called to show the love of Jesus to them as well as everybody else. It's really easy to love those people who are countlessly loving us. That's one of the easiest things to do, is reciprocate love to someone who's loving us. But it's a lot harder to love someone after they treat you poorly. But that's what we are called to do. We are called to believe, see, and then do. Another aspect of do is to be able to see like when people need your help. Jesus talks in the Bible, I'm not exactly sure which book, nope, can't remember, but he talks about, he asks people, he's like, if you saw me sitting there begging for money, would you give me money? Or if you saw me sitting there starving, would you feed me? Or if you saw me sitting there needing something to drink, would you give me water? How different would you all treat people if you saw everyone around you as Jesus? Would you care for them more? How many of you could honestly say that if you saw that person in the busy street or in the busy city, if you saw that person there begging for money, if he was Jesus, how many of you would not stop and at least talk to him? If we started treating everyone with the love that Jesus treats us with, this entire world would change. This entire world would change if we started seeing Jesus in every person around us. If we started loving them like he loves us, you would change this entire community. But in order to get to that point where you do, you have to believe and see first. Because without that being in your heart, without being full yourself, it's really hard to pour into others. It's really hard to invest in others, to love them, if you don't feel that love first yourself. But once you do, then you can go out and you can serve the community and you can change this world. And I think that it's super fitting that today is Communion Sunday, because this is the reason that we are able, that we feel that love, because Jesus came and he died for us. And that's what we remember when we take the sacrifice. Remember that love. And then we are called to share that love with others.